Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 13th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. And our main item of business this morning is to give consideration to the report into the administration of Scottish income tax for the year 2022-23. And I'm delighted to welcome our witnesses in the committee room this morning. We are joined by the Director General of the Scottish Exchequer, Alison Stafford. Good morning. Alison Stafford is joined by Lorraine King, who is the Deputy Director for Tax Strategy, Engagement and Performance in the Scottish Government. Good morning, Lorraine. Good morning. We are also joined by Jonathan Athau, who's the Director General for Customer Strategy and Tax Design at His Majesty's Revenue and Customs. And alongside Jonathan is Phil Batchelor, who's the Deputy Director for Income Tax Policy at His Majesty's Revenue and Customs. We've got a number of questions that we'd like to put to you, and we'll get to those shortly. But before we do that, I'd like to invite, first of all, Alison Stafford, and then I'll go straight to Jonathan Athau to give a short opening statement to the committee. Alison Stafford.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning. It's welcome that the National Audit Office and Audit Scotland continue to assess that HMRC has rules and procedures in place to properly assess and collect Scottish income tax. That said, we're not complacent, and the Scottish Government works with HMRC to examine further areas for improvement. I'd like to just highlight three areas that we focused on since last year's session with the committee. First, to support HMRC maintain a complete and accurate tax base and to be vigilant in identifying Scottish taxpayers, we have taken the decision to run the third-party data clash in 2024, and we're not waiting until 2025, which would be in the previous pattern. So that's one particular area that I thought was I'd want to draw to the committee's attention. Secondly, recognising the really vital role of compliance work, we've established a joint compliance working group. This draws on a range of subject matter experts from compliance business areas within and across HMRC. This will refresh the assessment of compliance risk, and so where any changes are needed, they can be addressed. Thirdly, we now publish the minutes of the Scottish Income Tax Board meetings. Those are published both on the Scottish Government and the HMRC websites to increase transparency of the measures planned and taken by that board. So we will continue to work with HMRC to ensure Scottish public finances are underpinned by tax administration arrangements that function effectively and as intended, and to ensure value for money for taxpayers. Any insights from the committee this morning are welcomed. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm now going to invite Jonathan Athau to give us his opening statement.
Thank you. So I would draw out two or three main points. Firstly, I'm not going to repeat what Alison said, but we have been running, administering the Scottish income tax system for a number of years now. We want to learn, we want to continue to innovate, and what the issues Alison addressed are really about how we continue to learn. This is a journey we're going on, and we need to make certain we reflect. There are important changes, so I was very pleased we were able to promptly introduce the new rate of Scottish income tax this year, and that reflects very close working with the Scottish Government, so I think that is a good example of how we can work together to deliver the agenda of the Scottish Government in terms of its views on income tax. We're also continuing to monitor what is going on. There were two reports published yesterday on how we are using data to understand what is happening with cross-border migration and also with how changes in or divergence between income tax rates in Scotland and the rest of the UK are affecting behaviour. That is something we will continue to do, we've invested in the data now, we can continue to monitor and understand what is going on. Which takes me on to my third point, and I'm certain something we will discuss throughout the committee's hearing, is the divergence between rates in Scotland and rates in the rest of the UK, and what that means for behaviours, what that means in terms of the work on compliance, again, picking up some of the things Alison talked about. And finally, I would like to thank the auditors for their work in looking through how we're administering the Scottish income tax system, and very grateful to their work, and very pleased with their audit report that there are no recommendations. But there are, of course, as we've said, things we need to continue to monitor and make certain we're on top of.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Before I invite the Deputy Convener to come in, can I just say that the committee, I think it would be fair to say, is disappointed that the two reports you produced came out less than 24 hours before you were appearing before this committee. I mean, my understanding is that one of the reports was due to be published back in January. Could you explain the timing of the publication of these reports?
Well, I wanted to make certain that these were out before before the committee. I think that would have been better that way round than after the committee. We have processes for clearing reports internally within HMRC and within the UK government, and that took a little bit longer than we would ideally have liked, but I was very keen that these are out. I'm certain, as I said, these are also investments in data that we will come back to. We have created that data set, that longitudinal data set, and we will be able to monitor that in future. So I'm hoping that we have now invested in the right data, the right analysis that will allow us to have the right conversations in the future.
Well, I mean, without overstating the obvious, publishing them before the committee could have been a week ago, could have been 2 weeks ago, could have been a month ago. And as I understand it, you didn't even give us the courtesy of informing us that you were about to publish that information.
On that, I apologise that we should have given you more of a heads up of what we were planning to do. Apologies.
Okay. Well, the committee, being resourceful as it is, will do its level best to tackle some of the issues that are raised in those two reports. And to begin with, I'm going to invite the Deputy Convener, Jamie Green, to put some questions to you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our guests. I want to get straight into the meat and bones of the content of the HMRC reports. There's over 100 pages to digest. As the convener said, we haven't had much time to do so. But what is contained therein has been the source of quite a lot of commentary over the last 24 hours in a variety of sources, both from an analysis point of view, but also from media and, unfortunately, as is always the case, from a political point of view as well. And it's important that the committee gets under the skin of some of the facts and figures. So I wondered if HMRC could enlighten the committee, what are the key findings of those reports? Because it singularly picks out the year 18-19, but nothing since then. So it is a snapshot, I understand that. And it seems odd that we haven't had any further analysis of any subsequent years. So maybe you could comment on that. But what I'd like to know is, what did you find when you analysed tax year 18-19 when Scotland moved to a five-tier system? What's the situation regarding our income tax base? Is it better, worse or indifferent?
Yeah, so I think I will give you a very high-level summary. And obviously part of the reason for wanting to publish these statistics is analysing what had happened and what would have happened without those tax changes is very difficult. Part of the process here is publishing that. I'm certain there will be discussions on the methodology by experts in that particular area. I think there are two things that are important. One, that we continue throughout the period to see net migration to Scotland from the rest of the United Kingdom. So we are seeing that. That continues. But what we are seeing, and there is some evidence that the divergence in rates slowed that migration. So there was a small negative effect on migration of the higher rates in Scotland. That is what you would expect from economic theory. That is what we did see. But those effects are relatively small. at the moment, and those are the sorts of things that the Scottish Fiscal Commission highlighted in their report when they are going about their business of looking at what the effects of higher rates in Scotland. So those effects, as I said, are what you would expect. They're relatively modest. The challenge with really estimating and keeping on top of this is the long lags in our data and also the effects of COVID. We might well get onto this, but the effects of COVID created uncertainty in economic modelling. It slowed and restricted people's ability to move in that way. So that creates a particular challenge for that for those years. And the way the income tax system works is there is a very long lag for self-assessment customers before we get the full picture of that, of what's happening with them. So that inevitably means much analysis of this type, which requires very, very good data, is likely to be quite heavily lagged.
Yeah, I understand that. I think I do have a concern, though, that if we have to wait 5 or 6 years before the sort of 50-page reports that produce that sort of data, that's impossible to inform government decisions.
Yeah.
Because that's just what's happened, not what might happen in the future. What we really need to know is what that trend has looked like over the last few years, particularly if there's been further diversions, as we know there has been, particularly in bans and fiscal drag. So as a result of that, you know, you said it was a small stroke moderate loss of income. Analysis in your own report says it's around £60 million in the financial year 18-19.
Yes.
But that equates to a very small amount of people. So it doesn't take a lot of behavioural change or a lot of people to drop out of the Scottish tax system for there to be a fairly substantial loss to the income that the government receives and therefore has available to spend in public services. Could you give us an indication of how worrying that figure might be? If you look, for example, at your own table, just 60 people coming out of the system at the top rate equated to nearly £38 million of loss of income, and that's huge.
So again, in terms of in terms of overall revenue raised by the Scottish income tax rate, that is a relatively small number. Yeah. So in that context, obviously in absolute pounds terms, that is significant. There's two things I would pick up on. One is, yes, this is backward looking, but it provides an estimate, to use the terminology, a semi-elasticity, which is how people respond to that divergence. And that can be used to look at future trends. So again, and again, the Scottish Fiscal Commission, for example, would take that into account in doing its appraisal of how future tax changes will affect revenue. So in that sense, whilst it's backward looking, it gives us some understanding about what will happen in the future, and it was deliberately structured in that way to give us some insight for the
future. So you could perhaps share your expertise this morning. What are people doing? If there is divergence, either more bans, higher tax rates, what sort of things do people do? Is it that they move out of the country? Is it that they don't take pay rises, they don't do overtime, they put more money into their pensions? Is there higher tax avoidance or evasion? What sort of things are the risks here when there is divergence?
So I think there is, let me distinguish between, say legitimate behaviours and then perhaps non-compliant behaviours. An important element here is migration. Populations, and it's a very, very dynamic, labour market. People move for jobs, move throughout the country. So there is a lot going on there, and that is one aspect we have looked at. We also looked at other responses. We didn't find a particular impact in terms of employment on this, so it's not affecting how many people. Or we've not found any evidence that it was affecting people's employment prospects. There are other ways in which people can respond. One of those would be sort of what we would call tax planning. Mm-hmm. So you might decide, I will put more of my income into pensions, into a pension, which is relief, which can benefit from tax relief. Those sorts of things. It might encourage somebody to think about, you know, timing their retirement slightly differently. But as I said, we didn't see a particular labour market impact. So probably you were going to get some migration effects. People who may have thought about coming to Scotland may choose not to. Those sorts of things. You might get some tax planning. I'm certain we'll come on to non-compliance. But non-compliance, again, you have to think quite carefully through the different sorts of taxpayers. If you're a PAYE taxpayer, so which is covers about, I think, about 85-87% of Scottish income tax, your ability to not comply is quite limited. Your tax is taken at source. It's a very effective an efficient way of collecting revenue, and I'm certain we'll come on to it later. But if you're a self-employed person, there is an incentive for you to, say, suppress your income, under-report your income. Mm. Now, actually, the difference between, say, the very highest rates, there's still a very strong incentive for you to under-report at, say, 45% income tax, as well as a 48%. So, again, I wouldn't want to overstate that the divergence there radically alters the incentives for people to be non-compliant. But as I said, there is that risk of non-compliance. Yeah. And you would particularly think about people, say, who are self-employed, where they have, where we don't have that deduction at source and we don't have that real-time information that we do for employees. So hopefully that gives you a sense.
It does, yes. And of course, you don't need to be ultra-rich for this divergence to affect you. In fact, earning just £50,000 is a 20% differential between income tax rates, and that therefore could have a affect a much wider range of people. Ms. Stafford, I wanted to come on to you. You're obviously Director General of the Scottish Exchequer. Is it a concern to the Scottish Government that just 16% of Scottish taxpayers pay over 62% of the tax base, and therefore any changes in that? In the volume of people in those bands or any behavioural changes, as we've seen from the 18-19 report, will have a huge and detrimental effect on the amount of money the government has to spend?
So let me just start off by just saying, actually, the whole idea of us having the research that HMRC has taken forward and actually previous studies, so we did a 2018-19 evaluation, which was published in December 2021, we've got these two reports, and those will obviously then continue. We've got that database. So we're committed to working through these policy evaluations and publishing them and taking the learnings from them. From the point of view of the behavioural response, and it is something that is taken into account in providing advice to ministers each time tax policy is being set. As Jonathan has said, there's the independent assessment of whatever the policy is that's produced by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And so I think what's really interesting from this particular study is that we are seeing that since the introduction of Scottish income tax for Scotland overall in 2017-18, more taxpayers have come to Scotland than have left, and inflows averaging around 4,200 per year. I realise the questioning so far has particularly looked at one year, the 2018-19 one, which Jonathan has taken us through. But I think the other thing is important to look at the whole of the study that was published yesterday, and in 2021-22, which is the latest available year of data, the net migration was positive across all tax bands and almost all age groups. So, like you say, we are vigilant. We look at the distribution, and like you say, there's an important aspect around that. But this latest data that we have is showing that position in 2018-19 wasn't replicated in the last stages of the analysis. And that net migration being positive across all tax bands, I think, is encouraging to see. In 2021-22, taxable income in Scotland decreased actually by 200 million as a result of the positive inward migration of taxpayers. So I think the important thing is that we have the data. It is there for us all to see and to analyse. And I do see that there are some whilst there is that change in 2018 when the tax, more bans were introduced, subsequently in the more recent years we've seen actually net migration positive and across all bans.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it was notable that the Scottish Government were very, very quick to comment publicly on the net migration figure, but from what I can read and looking through various commentators of the last 24 hours, where it's the Institute of Directors, Fraser Valander, the Scottish Financial Enterprise Association, and a whole bunch of other analysts and commentators who we often heavily rely on for independent, neutral analysis, are all saying the same thing, that the numbers themselves are quite meaningless if you're only looking at the net migration figure. That actually what matters is how much money is coming into the system and how much money is being lost from the system. And that goes back to my original question, which I'm not sure was answered, which is that if we lose higher top-rate taxpayers, that has a much more substantial impact on the amount of money that comes into the system. And I guess what we don't have is a year-by-year analysis of that. It's very difficult for the committee to take a view, or anyone else to take a view on that, if we don't have the data.
So the longitudinal data set actually does cover a longer time frame than the 2018-19. And that's why I was also sharing with you that the latest date that's in it is for the 2021-22 tax year. And that is showing that taxable income increased by 200 million and net migration was across all tax bands in a positive direction coming into Scotland. And I think the other thing that Jonathan was saying as well is that there is, in terms of the impact on the labour market, there is nothing that's particularly impacting on that from the data that we can see so far.
So I think many would disagree with that. Anecdotally, we're hearing a number of voices being very vocal about maybe not necessarily the statistical analysis of migration, but the anecdotal, certainly, and the quantitative analysis of it, is that every respected industry body is saying that they're really struggling to recruit people, and that tax divergence is the primary cause of that. So I hear what you're saying, but business leaders are saying the entire opposite to you.
And I hear what you're saying too, and I think, you know, in response, we have the data so far up to 2021-22 that's been produced with the statistical kite mark, and it's good at least that we're able to be looking at that now. And today is the first opportunity for us to be working that through with you. There will be, as Jonathan said, subsequent sets of data that will come through. There is, though, this lag. And I think that is the thing that is something we all just have to be mindful of, that there is a lag there.
Okay, if you're not, I know others have got a lot of interest in this.
Yeah, thank you. Can I just ask a very quick question to you, Alison Stafford? You're the Director General of the Scottish Exchequer. You've got a service level agreement with HMRC. When did you first get sight of these reports?
Personally, I saw these reports on Monday.
Okay. When did the Scottish Government first see drafts of these reports? Lorraine King?
So Scottish ministers had access to the results from the reports when they were making their budget decisions for the draft budget that was published in December last year. The results haven't changed since then, but we've had interim results throughout that period.
So, again, I'll repeat that my understanding is that this, at least one of these reports was due to be published in January, and ministers have had sight of it last year. Why was it only yesterday that the Public Audit Committee of the Scottish Parliament, which is conducting an inquiry into the administration of Scottish income tax, received it? Could somebody explain that? Alison Stafford, can you explain that?
So I would need to revert to Jonathan, because Jonathan has already explained that the report is actually published by HMRC and has to go through HMRC's clearance processes.
But it was shared with ministers last year.
There is a nuance here that the final report has only been drawn up relatively recently. But as we share relevant information about that affects Scottish policy making, we will share that information. So some of the interim results would have been shared because that was germane to ministers making decisions. I recognise that's a nuance, but just to clarify that
particular. Yeah, I mean, one of the reports we're discussing here is the Auditor General's report, where he says, and let me quote him, that getting some of this longitudinal analysis on behaviour, for example, direct quote, will help inform future tax policy decisions and enable more informed scrutiny. That's why we're here. So I find it extraordinary that you've had this information in whatever form that you've not shared with us as members of the Parliament. Do you not see anything wrong with that?
I take that point, and as I said, I do apologise in particular for not engaging with the committee more in a more structured way in the run-up to the publication of those reports.
Okay, but I think that from our perspective, we also direct some of those criticisms to the Scottish Government. I accept it's a HMRC publication, but if the Scottish Government has had access to it, why was it not prepared to share that with the Scottish Parliament?
I think the key thing is waiting for the report to be final, so that could actually know that it had gone through all the appropriate scrutiny that has to happen to make sure that the statistical validity of it is there. So that is the reason.
So ministers were setting the budget on the basis of information that might have been statistically invalid?
Sorry, what we would normally do not just restricted to this, but what we would always want to do is make certain ministers have all the information that is available. Some of that information has been validated and will have been completely signed off. Some of it is early indications. Whenever we advise ministers, whether that's ministers in Scotland or UK ministers, we're very clear with them. We want them to have the full information we have, but we also want them to understand some of that information may be more robust than others. Some of it might be early indications. But that is our approach, is to... When ministers are making decisions, try and make certain they have all the relevant information, even if it is unpublished or initial estimates.
But the ministers make proposals to Parliament, and the decision on income tax rates and so on is set by the Parliament as a whole, not just by the government. I'm going to move on now because we've got other questions that we want to put, and Graham Simpson wants to come in on a quick point regarding
this. It's just on this subject. I'm struggling to understand what the delay was, you know, who was responsible for the delay in publishing these reports. You indicated earlier, Mr. Atho, that it had to go through a process.
Yes.
So at some point, that process has slowed down. So where was the block?
So we sit down with ministers. We sit down to look at them about a wide variety. We publish a lot of information. We will put a sort of timetable together. Sometimes that will be slowed down because at a particular stage somebody wants to understand something. What is behind this? As we've discussed, there is a lot of information that's come out in these reports. So there'll be often an understanding of what we're intending to publish. And so that can just mean an extra stage of, can you please clarify this? Can you explain how this will... what this means, what the implications of this research is. So often it will be those stages. It's often not a particular decision, but sometimes the cumulative effect of extra information being asked for or clarification being sought by ministers.
So at some point a minister, we're probably talking about a UK minister here, said, you can't publish this yet, it's not ready, go away, come back with more.
It would not often be that sort of decision. It would often be, can I understand more? You've put this in front of me. Can I understand what the implications of this are? What's the scope of this? How will this be interpreted? It will often be extra questions that are being asked, and that sometimes slows down the process.
I'll bring Graham Simpson back in later on, but I want to bring Willie Coffey in at this juncture. Willie.
Thanks very much, convener. I suppose I'm slightly less concerned about the hoo-ha, but timing with reports rather than the the key messages that are contained within them. I think that's the most important thing to focus on today. I am curious, though, initially, Jonathan, about two reports coming out yesterday. The intra-UK migration report, which has some fairly positive messages in there for the Scottish Government, I think. But the 2018-19 report that Jamie referred to has slightly more negative coverage in that, I would suggest. Could you explain why a 2018-19 report is only appearing yesterday, almost 5 years after it perhaps could have been?
So, part of you're absolutely right. As I said, I think there are two sides of the coin here, and I think net migration continues to be positive, but there is some evidence that the change divergence in rates has dampened migration to Scotland. Part of the issue here is creating the underlying database. All of that data was there, but it needed to be pulled together in a way that allowed us to understand what was going on. As I said, we don't normally set up our systems to track individuals over time, but what we've done now is invested in this database. We think it's really important because, as Mr. Green said, there have been further changes that will need to be analysed and understood. So part of it was investing in the data to make certain we've got the database. Now we've got that, that allows us to look back at 2018, 2019, but that also means we've invested in the database, and as more data comes along, we'll be much more able to do much more quickly, we'll be able to analyse what the effects of, say, the 2024-25 changes to the tax system is. So it was really the investing in the getting the database right. We think this is very useful, much more generally. Obviously, I'm here talking about Scottish income tax, but we also have Welsh rates of income tax. At the moment, they're aligned with the rest of the UK. If that changes, the investment in the database we have will allow the Welsh government as well to understand what the impacts are there. So we would making it what I would describe as a strategic investment in the data, and that did take some time to get it right. It's now also going to be available to researchers, so independent researchers will be able to access this database. So I'm hoping we have done something now that we've invested for the long term. That's how I would characterise it. But it did take some time and effort to set this up. It's not a straightforward. The data does not automatically fall out of our systems in a way that allows this analysis to be done.
I mean, I understand that, but a 2018-19 report is five-year-old data. Surely the findings around that time could have been shared, even in advance of developing your data analysis methodologies and database stuff.
Yeah.
Surely the messaging in there could have been released far earlier. Why yesterday, outside this report?
So the 2018-19 data, the final data for 2019 would not have been reported to us until January 2020. So again, there are long lags in this system. So even then, we would have, we could have perhaps got this data or this analysis a couple of years earlier, but not much more than that. And I think there was a bit of a decision about whether you do the 2018-19 data or do you invest in building the data set for the future. We made a decision. I'm certain other people may have said that we should have done something different to invest the time and effort in building something that can be reused for the future rather than just for the 2018-19 analysis. It's also, one of the, we are learning as we're working together with the Scottish Government about what the analytical needs are. We only started down this journey on this current system in 2016, so we are learning, and again, I think some of this is about learning what your needs are, learning what the needs of the Scottish Government are as we're going through this. So I think there is a bit of learning. If we knew then what we know now, we probably would have invested in that database from the get go.
Okay, perhaps a question or two for both you, Jonathan and Alison. I mean, turning to the 21-22 data, which is much more positive. I mean, the previous predictions of gloom and doom about the policy now established with this report have proven to be untrue. And as Robert Burns said, facts are chills that win a ding. Once you get facts, you can't overturn them. So all data is helpful and we're all able to interpret it in the ways that we choose. And you've seen that in the press and the media. But nevertheless, the 21-22 report does have positive indications for the tax base in Scotland. So could you summarise what the key findings are from your point of view, Jonathan, in the 21-22 data?
I will go back to some very high-level messages that Scotland continues to see inflows of taxpayers. So I think there is positive evidence there. But as I said, the implication of the analysis from 2018-2019 is those inflows are probably lower than they would have been without the divergence. And essentially, that becomes a trade-off for ministers to consider in making their decisions. So yes, it is not, as you say, complete doom and gloom, but there is some evidence we are seeing that number in 21-22 plausibly could have been higher if there had not been the divergence. But again, that is a decision ministers will have to make, weighing up all the factors that are relevant to setting Scottish income tax, including where that money is spent. That that becomes ultimately a decision for ministers on those issues of trade-offs and again, I think this is not unique to Scottish income tax. You know, we've done similar analysis of what happens to UK income tax income tax rates, and again, ministers must always make trade-offs about how taxes will fall, where they might affect behaviour, and whether that's the right decision for them. But that essentially becomes a political decision.
Yeah. And from your point of view, Alison, from the Scottish Government's point of view, you must be encouraged by the most recent findings in the 21-22. But what are we collectively doing? And Jamie Green was asking about this, to really monitor behavioural change in all its facets. Do we, in your data analysis, data collection, try to find out why people do what they do and also why they decide not to make changes? Do we look at the whole blanket of those particular issues to see what affects people's behaviour?
So it might be something in terms of those other behavioural aspects. We could turn to HMRC as well. But let's just start off, and you were asking very specifically about 2021-22. So two key facts on that have come out from this longitudinal data set is that in that 2021-22 year, which is the last available year of data, net migration was positive across all tax bands and almost all age groups. In 2021-22, taxable income in Scotland increased by 200 million as a result of this positive inward migration of taxpayers. And certainly taking the overview in the round of all the various elements that ministers take into consideration in setting tax policy, then the move to a more progressive income tax system in 2018-19 found that policy did raise additional revenue for investment in public services. And at that particular point in time, it was assessed as around £230 to £245 million. And that continues to be borne out, that those structural changes have increased overall the tax take and revenue that's been raised for investment in public services. A couple of other key points, and then I'll stop before we then move on to, well, what sort of things do people take into consideration? So the study, and this is particularly looking at the study that was alongside the longitudinal data set, and this is the one that's extensive TIES, which stands for the taxable income elasticities. The study did not find any evidence of an impact on labour market participation resulting from the 2018-19 reforms. And more high-earning taxpayers did come to Scotland than left in that last tax year of data of 2021-22. like you say, you know, there are a number of things, though, that will impact on the choices of where people choose to live and work. So we've already heard that the labour market factors have not been a factor. There will be other things that will be cost of living more generally. There will be family ties, overall quality of life. Those are the sorts of things that we're aware will impact on where people choose. Clearly, the committee have other sources of what have been described as anecdotal data. It will be interesting to understand what sort of data HMRC does have on those sorts of factors. But given what's been involved in actually getting to the longitudinal data set just on the migration numbers, it would be interesting if there is anything that's richer and deeper than that. But you're right, there are much, much broader considerations that people will take and not just what the rate of taxation.
So just to come in on some of that. So we can certainly, we often certainly see what happens, but not necessarily why it happens. you know, when you put your tax return in, you tell us what you've done,
not why you've done it,
but not necessarily why you've done it. We are able to monitor in close to real time employment trends across the United Kingdom, including providing good geographical data on Scotland. So every month, data is published on employment levels. These are people who are employees. Self-employment is much harder to moderate, but we do that every month. We publish payrolled employees, so real-time data in terms of employment is there. We then are able, through this database and through the other data we have, to understand what is going on, and from that we can surmise sometimes, are people, for example, putting more money into pensions or those sorts of things. But actually, there is it's a very decisions on migration, decisions on how much to work, where to work, how to work, are quite complex. And again, many factors will be part of that. Sometimes tax is one of them. But as I said, we found some evidence that tax does affect migration to Scotland, but we've not found any evidence so far that the difference in tax rates, as Alison said, has affected anyone's decisions to work or not work. But these are things we need to keep on top of, things we need to understand. There's also an aspect here, as I said, of some of the behaviours you can see here are sort of not behaviours we would like, you know, avoidance, evasion type behaviours. We've got some evidence there that, again, about kind of why people do that. Often people do these things because they think other people are doing it or their friends are doing it and telling them of those sorts of things. So we have some evidence, but I'm afraid it's not particularly, it doesn't give you neat answers, I'm afraid. And in some ways, I think probably expecting neat answers when people are making decisions about their lives is probably not also likely either, I'm afraid.
Yeah, if I just lastly for me, convener on this, I mean, we kind of all skipped past the mathematical analysis content of the report, I suppose, but I just come back to that. Is it worthwhile? Are both governments interested in why people do what they do in relation to important matters like this? And is that something that we could think about in the future to conduct that separate part of the analysis of why this behavioural change in its many facets occurs in offer? Because otherwise we'll interpret it as we see fit around this table.
So I think we do want to know this. Again, we're not the only source of the analysis here. Part of this is making certain there is that researchers are able to look at the hard data, but also do some of the other research. And I know of some research projects that are looking sort of attitudes to sort of changes in tax and kind of how people affect that. But again, we're interested in that. You know, for our core role, we're really interested in the numbers.
Yep.
As an audit committee, that's kind of you can understand that. But we do want to affect behaviour. We don't want people to get into avoidance schemes or to be evading. So we do need to understand those sorts of behaviours. So we would like to understand more. It is quite hard, but they're going to be the only source of evidence. You know, there are many researchers out there looking at these sorts of questions, and they will have as valid an input, if not more so than we would have.
Okay, thank you for that. I'll hope to come back later on the S codes issue.
Yes.
Other colleagues are waiting to ask some questions. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to invite Graham Simpson to put some questions to you at this point. Graham.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think you're all correct that, you know, people make decisions on where to live for all kinds of all sorts of reasons, and it doesn't just come down to how much tax you pay. There might come down to how much tax you pay, but I think you'd probably be having to pay quite a lot of tax to if that was what was making you move. I just wanted to ask you, Mr. Atho, having a quick read of your report, I wonder why you use such complex mathematical formulas that even experts that have managed to get hold of can't get their heads around. Yeah.
So, firstly, what we want to do is present credible evidence that stands up to external scrutiny, and as a part of the publication approach here, is to make certain that the experts, we're talking about Fraser Vallander and others, are able to understand what we've done and critique it. The real challenge here is what we are trying to estimate is essentially what would have happened if there had been no divergence. We will never know that with certainty. So what we have to use is mathematical models that try and estimate what would have happened if Scottish income tax rates had remained in alignment with the rest of the United Kingdom. And that is the really challenging part of the analysis. And that requires some quite complex techniques, because the demographics of Scottish taxpayers are different from the from the rest of the United Kingdom. So we'd expect there to be differences anyway. We have to control for those. We have to control for the fact that the economies may have moved slightly differently between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. So necessarily that requires some quite complex analytical techniques. Now, those techniques are well understood. There's quite a lot of literature on this about how this is applied elsewhere. I'm not an expert, but you know, you see, for example, in the United States, quite a lot of difference between taxes between different states. That means there is a sort of well-trodden research. So we need to make certain we are accurate as we can be, that we are not confusing matters, because there are these extraneous factors, like I said, different economic challenges. So we have to use the right techniques to bring that out. As always, and I'm an economist by background, is the key thing is making certain you explain that as clearly as possible, what the implications of those things are. So hopefully we can try and do more of that now we've got these technical reports out. But it is very important that we are robust in what we are doing, so we can offer the best evidence. Necessarily that requires some quite complex techniques. But hopefully that sort of sets out a little bit as to how we go about doing these things. And the challenge is, as I said, trying to work out what would have happened if we'll never observe that world where Scottish income tax rates did not diverge from the rest of the UK, but what would have happened if that had been the case is very difficult. And that's the heart of the problem and why we need these complex mathematical techniques.
Okay. I'm not going to ask you to explain any of these formulas.
Yeah, no.
Maybe.
Thanks, school, Mr. Simpson.
Yeah. Yes, I might have to. But no doubt maths experts will maybe come back to us with a view. Right, I've got some other questions, and it goes back to a previous session we've had. Simple question, anyone can answer it. Do we know where every taxpayer lives in Scotland, or indeed across the UK?
So we, as the UK, we do not have a sort of population register where people have to, by law, declare where they are living. So compared to, say, other countries, say Scandinavian countries, that means we have slightly less robust data. So we rely on two channels of reporting, either individuals telling us where they live, or that more common is employers telling us where people live.
Yep.
So that is our main source of information. As we've talked about before, we check that by the jargon is we clash the data, we compare our data to other databases about where people live. That gives us quite high levels of confidence, but it's always going to be challenging when we, given the way we are relying on individuals to report that data or employers to report that data. And there's no other database. There is no national database we can go and check that against, yeah. I think, is the challenge.
I would just stop you there. So it's not a legal requirement for people to tell HMRC where they live. We know that.
Yes. Yeah.
That's a fact.
Yes, yes.
So therefore, people could, if they tell you anything, they could lie, potentially.
Yes. Now, to be able to sort of carry that off, you would need an address where, for example, you could take post from. Mail out some information. Obviously, we do use digital means, but often we are mailing things out to people. So you would need maybe a second address or something like that. So there are circumstances in which people could misrepresent their address. And again, certainly one of the things we'll want to sort of consider in the future and why we want to do the data clash on a more regular basis is in the recent past, the differences in tax rates between Scotland and the rest of the UK have not been large enough, not been particularly large, and therefore the incentive to misrepresent your address has been lower. Now we're aware that particularly with the changes that are coming in this year, that differential has grown. So it's something we need to be alive to. But that's how we thought of it in the past, but how we're also alive to the fact it might change.
That divergence almost. It creates an incentive. If let's say you've got two addresses, they're both legitimate addresses.
Right? Yes.
One's your main home, one's your second home. You could flip addresses for the purposes of HMRC.
Yeah.
You could tell HMRC, well, actually, my main address is in England and not in Scotland. You could do that.
In theory, yes. But we would want to make certain that was your true address, and we do have a residency test we can look at. And so, if we thought there were concerns, and again, that's kind of why we would use things like a data clash to sort of, if you're telling a private sector company one thing about where you're resident, and you're telling us something different, that would be something we would be interested in.
Mm-hmm.
And it might well be, we would then need to work out what the true situation is. So we can do those tests.
Okay.
And as I said, at the moment, we are not seeing particular angles of areas of concern. When we do that matching to private sector data, we're getting good levels of match. But as I said, we are thinking that incentive is changing over time, that incentive is growing.
Yeah.
So we need to make certain we're responding appropriately.
So a question for Ms. Stafford. Could the Scottish Government legislate to make it a legal requirement to inform HMRC if you've changed address?
I think that's one I would want to take away and actually get some legal advice, and I'm happy to write and come back to the committee on that.
Okay, that would be useful. Same question to you, Mr. Atho. Could the UK government legislate?
I think it could do. I think we would want, in advising ministers, I would want to think about, is that a sort of proportionate response to the risk? At the moment, as I said, I don't think there's huge evidence we're seeing particular concern. The challenge with sort of making something a legislative requirement is then it has to be policed. And we, I think sort of fining people or if they've not updated their address with us, that would be something I think ministers would be, I could see them being nervous about. So again, I think it's about proportionality to the risk, I think would be the concern.
But because we have different tax rates across the UK, then address becomes important.
Yeah.
And you've said already that you do spend time checking out whether the information people give you is accurate.
Yes, and again, simply requiring somebody to report a change of address does not necessarily mean it will be the correct one if people wish to misrepresent. So we would still need to do some enforcement activity. You know, as I said, most people provide, you know, large numbers of people. Yes, occasionally if people are moving house, you know, if they're flat sharing and they're moving around, maybe their addresses are not as up to date. But for the large, you know, for the large proportion of people, you know, the 90% plus, I think we're very confident of having up to date address information. So again, the question would be: would it be a proportionate response to the risk?
Okay.
Risk we face.
I've got a couple of other areas I want to look at. One's around tax debt, and then after that, I'm going to look at. There was a section in the earlier report that we had round about pension contributions.
Yes,
so
yeah.
I'll ask about that. So first of all, tax debt. It's an area that we've explored before. UK tax debt in 31st of March 2023 was £43.9 billion, according to the National Audit Office report. But we don't... seem to have a breakdown of where that debt falls in across Scotland, England and Wales. So I suppose a question for you, Ms. Stafford, I mean, does the Scottish Government intend to build up an accurate picture of what the tax debt is in Scotland?
So we actually do get some estimates through from HMRC. So I'll leave Jonathan to explain how that is arrived at. It is an estimate, and that's worked through as a particular percentage of UK tax debt. As I say, there is an estimate that we are provided with, and that is.
But it's only an estimate.
It's only an estimate.
Why is it only an estimate, Mr. Arthur?
So. I can take you back to the sort of two ways in which we collect income tax. For self-assessment, we know where people are in the main, or don't have a particular concern with them, or a concern of not knowing their address. So again, we can identify there. For PAYE, often where debt arises there is because the employer has not paid over tax they have collected. And if you are a UK-wide employer, we may not know exactly how much of that tax relates to a particular individual. So you know, if you are a large supermarket chain operating across the UK, and you don't pay over entirely hypothetical situation, you don't pay over your income tax. We may not know exactly how that underpayment relates to particular taxpayers. So it's the way we administer PAYE. In many ways, it's a lot simpler for the individual that way round, but does limit what we can understand in terms of that debt. So again, it's that is part of the challenge for why it is problematic. Now, we do not see Scotland having a particular or a larger share of debt than we would expect. I think the evidence we've got is slightly below the UK overall position. But again, that's something we would want to monitor and understand. But there are, again, limitations on our data, and PAYE is a particular source of that challenge.
I don't understand why that is. I mean, you said earlier PAYE is a relatively simple thing. I mean, surely, you know, you know, PAYE, your employer pays your tax for you. It should be working.
In many cases, it is, but obviously there are large amounts of money. You know, I think it's about 87% of Scottish income tax comes through PAYE.
Uh-huh.
And if you have an employer that might be in financial difficulty, and, you know, we are seeing businesses in distress, they may be not paying over their PAYE as promptly as we would like, and therefore as a debt. And therefore, whilst it's small numbers, so just to give you a sort of rough sense, we think the tax gap, so that's how much we don't collect on PAYE, is around 1%. But given PAYE is, as I said, 87% of Scottish revenues, that 1% is quite substantial.
What's the figure?
So I'm just doing some quick maths in the back of my head, but I think that would probably be around 100 million or so would be the sort of, you know, what the tax gap would be, assuming it's spread equally.
Is that in Scotland? Or?
In Scotland.
So 100. So yeah. 100 million pounds.
I'm doing some numbers in the back
roughly,
of my head.
Roughly.
roughly.
You've done this in your head. So roughly 100 million pounds. Owed.
That's the sort of, again, back to overall tax compliance. We would say that, roughly speaking, there is 100 million a year in PAYE we are not collecting that
in
is relevant to Scotland. And again, I'm doing some quick mental arithmetic, but that gives you a sense that, well, 1% is quite.
That seems quite a bit. That's a big figure. And yes. You're saying that that comes down to, or can come down to, employers not handing the money over.
Yes, indeed. And
as
said,
that's a serious issue.
It is. Often it's related to debt. If companies are in distress, they have a number of creditors who are pursuing them. We will be one of them, but there may well be others. There are issues there for those companies. But as I said, my point is, while 1% sounds small, when you apply it to a large number, it gives you a large number.
It comes to a big number.
Yeah.
And that is that's money.
Yes.
That's not flowing to. Miss Stafford's department.
Yeah.
Miss Stafford, you must have a concern about this.
Yes, absolutely. That's why it's really important that we continue to support HMRC with all the various work in terms of compliance and then following up on once the tax has been calculated that it is collected. There is work that HMRC carry out to improve the yield that comes from the tax that is due. And I know that there are targets that are set nationally for HMRC as part of their work is across the whole of the income tax base. And we look to HMRC, obviously, to continue to be vigilant and to close that gap as much as possible.
OK. I just think you should all be doing better on that. Seems a relatively straightforward thing. You'll know which employers are not paying what they should. I'll leave that there because I want to ask about this pension issue. And this was from the National Audit Office report. So we're looking at the section on pension contributions. I'm just going to read it out for the record. So pension scheme administrators must identify Scottish taxpayers so that tax relief is correctly allocated. The administrators claim tax relief at source on behalf of their members and add this to their members' contributions. HMRC's relief at source system automatically confirms the residency status of pension scheme members. Well, of course, you have to know where people live, and we don't necessarily, to ensure the correct relief is applied at source. It applies tax relief on pension contributions at the basic rate of 20% for all taxpayers. Scottish taxpayers paying a tax rate above 20% can claim the remaining tax relief through a self-assessment return or by contacting HMRC. And my issue with this is how many people actually know that they can do this or realise it's an issue.
This is a more general issue. What we see is most pension scheme administrators are very keen to point this out to individuals because actually it's a benefit to them. It is saying, please come and invest with us and you will get tax relief. It's part of how they market some of these schemes. So, but we do require people, as I said, to make that claim. So again, it is dependent on them. We will be very clear in guidance. People will often, if they are investing in pensions, will want to understand their tax position. We try and be as clear in guidance around that, and we will sometimes have targeted information that we can use then to either contact people directly or raise awareness in a particular group if we're interested in that. But that's a wider issue. It affects in the rest of the UK. It would affect higher rate taxpayers as well.
But why can't Scottish taxpayers have this, dealt with at source, so that they get the correct relief at source? Why do they have to fill it, put it down on a self-assessment form?
So, part of the challenge with a lot of the way the tax system works is we don't know people's full tax position until the end of the year. So we need to be able to look at where did you end up in the tax band at the end of the year and apply that correctly. As I said, in the rest of the UK, that could be, you what side of the high rate boundary you could be, obviously depending on where you are in Scotland, depending on which rate you're in. But that can only really be determined at the end of the year exactly what your true relief should have been. So it can only really be determined at the end of the year. We do the basic rate relief because we're assuming anybody who's claiming this or will be a basic rate taxpayer. So that's the minimum they can give. So we're giving them the minimum they can back in real time. And then any top up they have to claim because we cannot calculate that in real time. It's an annual system. And particularly, if you are, say, have a more complex tax affairs where you've got employment income, you might have some savings income. We know there are a number of people who may be landlords as well, have a share of landlords. That can only be brought together at the end of the year to work out where people's tax position is. So that requires an end of year process for us to go through. And really, we do need people to engage with that process to make certain we get that tax right.
Okay. I'll leave it there, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to bring Colin Beattie in shortly, but before I do that, can I just turn your attention back to the Controller and Auditor General's report on the administration of Scottish income tax? Because he says something which he's said in previous years, which is along the lines of this. Page 9, HMRC does not have Scotland-specific data on compliance risk. HMRC has limited performance data available about its compliance activities in Scotland. This may not be sustainable in the longer term. Alison Stafford, you mentioned in your opening statement that you were establishing a joint compliance working group. Is that working group going to tackle those deficiencies?
It will certainly start to work through quite a lot of those areas and to reassess where the risk is and where there might be the opportunity for more specific things. And I think it's important for us to pull out that actually part of what we do is actually seek further data through the year from HMRC on things that might have particular resonance for things that are distinct here in Scotland. So as I say, we have agreed that we will require the third-party data clash to take place in 2024, and that is the point about actually trying to ensure that the important issues that committee members have already brought out about addresses and actually establishing a really robust tax base is there. So that data clash is one thing. We have already requested some analysis from HMRC on paper migration. So this is really going to Mr. Simpson's point about when people feel that they have a choice as to where they declare as their main place. This whole area of paper migration and the underlying data. So that is a particular area of scrutiny, which again is trying to mitigate some of these compliance issues. I know one of the committee members has already mentioned in passing about S codes, and I'm sure we will return to that topic. But we have also been working with HMRC's monitoring of the correct use of S codes and wider taxpayer identification in that regard. And we certainly requested some additional data on S code misapplication by employer size, just to see if there was some distinct different treatment on there. Actually, that didn't yield anything worthy of further investigation, but it will certainly be something that we will continue to keep under review. And actually, this last point about pensions is really relevant, because clearly we've been talking a lot about tax policy changes here in Scotland. There were two important tax policy changes that apply to the whole of the UK, made by the UK government in something that's reserved, which is around pensions. And in 23-24, the annual allowance was increased for pensions up to 60,000 from 40,000. And in the current year, the pension lifetime allowance has been abolished. So this is an area that touches on what Jonathan was saying about tax planning and the extent to which there may be different motives with different arrangements that come through on pensions. So again, we're in discussion with some of the analytical experts in HMRC regarding some bespoke data analysis with regards to that element. So those are just some really tangible examples of the areas which we are looking to HMRC to undertake to really continue to understand and mitigate as far as possible some of those risks that you have read out and the Auditor General has underlined. So I think that gives you some of the sense of the things that we continue to strive for some better information of, and also therefore to mitigate some of those further risks of compliance.
Okay. I mean, could you share with the committee the terms of reference of the Joint Compliance Working Group? Could you tell us what its makeup is? I don't mean necessarily right here, right now. I mean, it would be useful, I think, if you could furnish the committee with a bit more information, perhaps outlining some of the areas of work that you've just told us about. Because, as I say, going back to my originating question, there were some quite clear areas addressed in that report by the Comptroller and Auditor General around compliance where further work could be done. And I think if there are gaps that can be closed, I go back to a point I've made in a previous year, which is this service level agreement is, I think, something the Scottish Government pays £600,000 for, and we're talking about a tax yield of up to £15 billion. So I think our view as a committee has been in the past, and I think still is, that maybe if that was revisited and perhaps a more generous settlement was reached, a lot more useful data could be produced and shared with the government, with Parliament, and those of us who have to scrutinise what's going on with the administration of Scottish income tax.
Yeah, so just to respond, obviously the tax take will be even higher for 24-25. It will be just under £19 billion that comes through from income tax.
That's an estimate, presumably.
It is the estimate that's provided by the Scottish Fiscal Commission that is factored into our budgets. It is then an amount that we know we can deploy in 24-25 because the fiscal framework allows us to have certainty on that. If there's anything different in the actual performance, then that's where the fiscal framework will bring in a reconciliation down track. But that whole area of compliance is something that we are absolutely vigilant on in ensuring HMRC's systems, which have been continued to be given the green light by NAO and Audit Scotland, but those systems are actually vigilant in ensuring that we are able to maximise the tax take fairly based on the rules and the policies that have been set here for Scotland. I'm very happy to set out for you what the terms of that working group will be and send that through, plus a small digest of those areas that I've explained we are absolutely vigilant on and working through.
Thank you. You're in danger of opening up another front, Director General, when you mention the fiscal framework, but I'll resist the temptation. Well, Colin Beattie.
If you want to get into complex formulae, that's definitely one of those other ones, but yes.
Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. Over the last several years, have expressed concern about the accuracy of the figures that we're getting for the Scottish income tax. And in 2021 and 2022, I actually extracted lists of all the areas where HMRC did estimates, guesstimates, UK-based averages and all sorts of things, all of which, in the aggregate, bring considerable uncertainty into the actual amount of income tax that relates to Scotland. Now, clearly, I didn't bother doing it this year because there was no change. Nothing has happened. I mean, there's no improvement in the accuracy of these figures and the elimination of some of the anomalies, which obviously and clearly are part of this. Does HMRC have a plan to eliminate these concerns?
So I think there are sort of two elements. There are going to be some things that are, unless there's a fundamental change in the way tax is administered, there are going to be challenges of administration. As I said, there is a long lag in self-assessment, so the data we've had reported just this January would relate to 2022-2023, so there are long lags in that. Some people will not have reported their data to us in January, and even now there will be some people who have not filed their tax return. So there will always be an element of us, unless there's a big change in how we administer it, there will always be a challenge that there will be people who are late filers. We will always have to estimate how many of those people come in. As I said, we talked about debt. We know sometimes what that debt will be, but we don't know how much of it will be paid. So sometimes we will always have to estimate how much that debt can be paid. But in other areas, we would want to learn and improve the way we operate. Can we find new ways of cutting data if there is a new IT system? Does that allow us to have more granular data for Scotland? So there will be some things I think we can improve, and some of that is just learning as you go through. As I said, we're into not quite to the first 10 years of this, but in the first few years you learn. And there will be things we can improve, but there are just going to be some challenges. You know, there will always be people who are late, who do not file with us, and we will always have to make an estimate for how many of those people finally file and tell us their tax affairs. And I can't see some of those fundamental things changing unless we make a really big change in how we administer tax, and that's certainly not on the cards at the moment.
But quite a few of these issues are Scotland related. Yeah. I can understand in the UK context there's well-tried and established procedures, and if it were the same for Scotland, then that would be more acceptable, because there's always a slight uncertainty. But the fact is that there's 30-odd areas here where basically you're sticking your finger in the air and hoping that the figures are going to be right. Now, surely some of these that are Scotland-specific, where we're trying to drill down to get the right figures and eliminate anomalies, surely some work should be getting done on that.
As I said, where we can, and again, it might be helpful to have that list of 30, and we can look at kind of where we think we can make areas, and where we think we can make progress, and all areas where there's more fundamental challenge. But again, where we have Scotland-specific data, we would want to try and use that. So I'm slightly going off piste here, but you know, if it's people not filing their self-assessment tax returns, ideally we would want to use Scottish figures to reduce that estimate, so we're not apportioning a UK-wide wide number. I don't know where we are in that work, but where we've got that data, we want to improve it. But again, if you have that list of 30, we could certainly look and give you an estimate as to kind of where we think there are fundamental things that are, you know, it's going to be very difficult to make change, and where we think there are incremental improvements we can make from using more Scotland-specific data.
Happy to share that with yourself and the committee. But given all these anomalies, which in my mind, at least in the aggregate, create a concern as to the final figure, I'm looking at the service level agreement of December 2023, And I'm looking at the first bullet point on clause 23, which says HMRC will identify the Scottish taxpayer population and collect from it the correct rate of SIT to ensure the Scottish Government receives the correct amount of income tax revenue each year. Can you put your hand on your heart and say that that is the case?
Well, we do our best to meet that.
It doesn't say we're going to do our best.
No, but as I explained, you know, there are challenges and limitations, for example, around, you know, addresses, and I identified those. But then we rely on the auditors to look and say, well, actually, given the uncertainties that are there, this is not a mechanical process of, you know, there are some estimates, there are some elements we have to do. Is this a fair statement? And the auditors have said it is. So we are doing our best to give the most accurate picture we can, recognising there are limitations in our systems. That means it's not possible to give you everything precisely to the nearest decimal point. We've got the best estimate we have, and the auditors have said that that is a fair estimate.
But just to clarify that particular point, in response to questions from this committee, the CNAG stated, our conclusion that the methodology is reasonable is not the same thing as saying that we are giving assurance on the number itself, and that's an important distinction in audit terms. So he's not saying your figures are accurate. He's saying that the methodology is acceptable.
Yeah, and I think in some ways that's as most as we can sort of hope to survive. We're very transparent about how we do this. If the auditors think there are improvements we need to make, we will make those. And as I said, the overall auditor's report is that these are fairly stated. But Alison, did you want to come in?
Yes, just from the point of view of wishing to be helpful, in that there are two areas that the National Audit Office and therefore the Auditor General comment on in relation to materials for particular tax years. So there's the tax year of 2021-22, where there is the actual calculation of income tax revenue, the actual outturn of what's collected, distinct from a forecast of what might be the actual tax collected for the subsequent tax year of 2022-23. It's that latter one, the future projection, which will have naturally a lot of estimation in it because it hasn't happened yet. And that second one isn't used and is not required to be used by the Scottish Government because we have to use the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the OBR numbers in determining what is the tax that will come in a future year. So I think the area that I place importance on from the reports that come out from the NAO is with regard to the actual income tax that has been collected for the year that is as complete as it can be, and that for this report is for the tax year of 2021-22. If colleagues were to look at page 13 in the NAO's report that focuses on the 2021-22 outturn, then 13.8 billion of the tax outturn has actually been established on known taxpayer liabilities that come through PAYE and self-assessment. The element that has any estimation about it takes that number of 13.8 billion to 13.7 billion. So the estimated elements are to the tune of 100 million, and those are drawn out from very quite specific things around what is happening with that self-assessed number, and that could be previous year's adjustments that are just coming through in that particular year. There are some deductions that come through that are to do with pensions and from gift aid. So it's just to give a sense that I think we're in danger of talking about two different types of exercise that the NAO comment on. And I think the area where there is estimation that I make sure and we drill into that's really relevant to Scotland is that outturn figure of the actual year. There is a lot that is in that estimation space then and looking forward, and we do not require to place any reliance on that. It is just for financial accounting reporting purposes that HMRC generate that. We rely here in Scotland on what comes through from the Scottish Fiscal Commission and also the Office of Budget Responsibility, because that's what actually drives the budget setting number for a future year here in Scotland. I don't know if that illuminates, but it was certainly intended to be helpful about where the risks really lie in estimation for us here in Scotland.
Are there areas where better data would be helpful?
Yes. Oh, absolutely. But recognising the fact that taxpayers don't necessarily respond neatly into the tax years, and there can be quite a lag, and people can take several years to actually update their tax affairs legitimately, and so therefore there are some estimates that need to be done.
Let me come back to the service level agreement. I'm quoting for one or two more bullet points here. Key requirements have been identified for HMRC's operation and administration of SIT powers. Identify and maintain an accurate and robust record of SIT taxpayer population. These are very strong statement. I'm not sure it's borne out by what we've heard. Again, it talks about HMRC to collect and account for the correct amount of income tax revenue due to the Scottish Government. And again, it goes about everything correct, robust, accurate, assurances, all the rest of it. I'm not sure we got that. I mean, are we actually complying with this service level agreement, or is it just a sort of statement of intent?
I think we are complying as far as possible we can within the constraints that we operate. As I said, you know, there are some uncertainties, as I was saying to Mr. Simpson, around addresses. There is always in income tax risks of non-compliance, and what we try to do is manage all of those risks. We've talked about addresses. We've talked about compliance risks, what we try and do to manage that. We've talked about debt. All of those things affect the final amount of tax collected for Scottish income tax, and we do our best to manage all of those risks and to give the most robust and the most accurate forecasts, accurate estimates of outturn we can. As we've said, the Auditor General thinks that those are fairly stated. So that gives us confidence. I think we are meeting our service level agreement.
Thank you, Peter.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I don't know whether Willie Coffey's got one final question to put. You can have the final word from the committee,
thanks,
Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's about the application of the S codes issue.
Yes.
Again, Jonathan, we ask about this every year. Every year we see that there are around 37,000 or so incorrectly applied codes by employers mainly. So my questions around this are, when will we ever resolve this? And is it the same employers, is it the same people that are not having their S codes applied? We ask these questions every year, but we never really get close to the answers to this. And what's the value placed on that potential loss of tax because of the misapplication of the S code?
So the S code we send to all employers where they have Scottish income taxpayers, and that means that the tax in year is correct. If somebody doesn't properly implement an S code, and say we assume they're a rest of the UK taxpayer incorrectly, what we do when we get to the end of the year is we will say, actually, the in-year collection has not been right, and there will be a reconciliation. Now, we want to avoid this, because what that can mean is somebody has not been paying the right tax through the year, so they might end up with a tax bill at the end of the year, which they might be, you know, is inconvenient for them to pay. You know, we would potentially collect it from a future tax year, but that's not what we want. We want to try and get people's tax right in year. But so there will be no loss to the Scottish Government. There is inconvenience to taxpayers from this. I would say is the best summary. And sometimes that inconvenience means unexpected tax bills, which can be difficult. What we also need to bear in mind, while the overall numbers of people in employment stay quite stable, the number of people starting and leaving employment in any one year is quite high. Around about a quarter of people, or a quarter of employments, turn over in any one year. So there's lots of people joining the workforce and leaving the workforce. It could be that you are a UK-wide business and you decide, I'm going to open a new branch in Scotland, and suddenly you will become somebody who has to deal with the Scottish income tax system. So while that number is quite high, and as I said, there can be problems for each of the individuals, in terms of the overall levels of employment and overall levels of churn, we don't see that as particularly problematic. My concern, you're absolutely lighted on the right area here, is if we are seeing people systematically not operating it, because it might well be that it's not just ESCOs that are the problem, they might be not operating other aspects of PAYE correctly. So we would be concerned if there are the same people year after year. We are not seeing that at the moment, but one of the things we have set up with the Scottish Government is a particular focus on this. So are there particular, say, sectors of the economy where people are not operating this, or are there particular areas? Because we want people to be operating the PAYE system well, because ESCOs are important, but it might also be symptomatic of a wider element. But as I said, coming back to my overall point, in general, we see the PAYE system operated well by employers. It's not a great source of concern to us. And as I said, there would not be a loss to the Scottish Government. There would be inconvenience to taxpayers would be the outcome of not applying ESCOs correctly.
OK, that's very clear that the reconciliation process basically returns the due correct amounts.
Yeah.
We were always interested in who they were. Even as you, are you able or willing to share that kind of information with us?
I would
not individuals, but employers.
Look back.
Is it high taxpayers that are always having this S-code error, or is it low tax code error?
Let me write to the committee on what we can say. It might well be sectors. My sense is it will be actually often employers where they may be relatively small. If you are a large, sophisticated employer, back to, you know, a supermarket chain that works across the UK, you have a very, very good payroll system that will work very well. It might well be that it's other sectors. But let me write and see what we can do on that, and whether it's larger or smaller businesses. Again, my assumption is it will be smaller businesses who may just, you know, they may only potentially have a handful of employees in Scotland, and those therefore may not be familiar with it. But I'm...
So there are 37,000.
Yes, indeed. So, but let me write to you about what we are seeing in that population and whether there are particular sectors or types of employers we are spotting as problematic. Often it's not the same employer year on year, because we will go out and reach out to them, and often they're very grateful that we've helped them, because often they may themselves know that they are struggling with their payroll.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We are out of time, so I'm going to draw this morning's session to a close. I think we've got some further questions which we might have to put to you, not least, frankly, because of the late arrival of those documents, which are lengthy and detailed and require proper scrutiny from the Public Audit Committee. We also will look forward to the further information that you both, Jonathan, Matthew and Atho and Alison Stafford, you said you'd supply to the committee. And I think I can say quite safely that Colin Beattie will supply you with his top 30 before the week is out to illuminate the points he was making about where he thinks there are still significant gaps. So with that, can I thank our witnesses, Phil Batchelor, who got off very lightly this morning, Jonathan Athau, Alison Stafford, Lorraine King got off quite lightly too, although she did make a very telling intervention, I thought. Can I thank you very much for your time this morning, and I'll now draw the public part of the committee's deliberations to a close, and we shall move into private session.